حسبي الله لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلت وهو رب العرش العظيم.
The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, سيأتي زمان على أمتي. There shall come a time upon my ummah, upon my nation, upon the people who follow me, upon the people who believe in me. They call themselves Muslims and believers. My ummah, when their prayers are not prayed correctly, and when high buildings spread in every place, when people swear in the name of Allah a lot about everything without fulfilling their oath, people curse each other a lot, bribery and adultery prevails, people neglect the hereafter in order to buy the luxuries of this world in exchange for the hereafter. So people become materialistic. Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, فَإِذَا رَأَيْتَ ذَلِكَ فَالنَّجَاةَ النَّجَاةَ. If you see this happening in your time, then seek refuge, seek refuge. Find a solution to get away from all of this. It's not an easy solution, but you need to stay away from all this. In one other hadith, a man said, Ya Rasulullah, what is seeking refuge? How do I seek protection? What do you mean by that? And Rasul gave an expression like this. He said, by adhering to your house and keeping your mouth shut and hold your tongue and hand from doing unlawful until death comes to you. There's going to come a time even worse than this one, brothers and sisters.
We have to understand, as Muslims, it's a journey. It's not a straight line. It's a journey. That's why it's the Deen tour, bro. It's a journey. You know, it's one day at a time. It's one step at a time. It's one salah at a time. It's one dua at a time. It's one subhanallah, alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar at a time. It's one at a time. Because for every single one, you know, you get multiple rewards. So we can't undermine the fact that, you know, our journey towards becoming better Muslims every single day is, like, it's a long one, but every single day that you do something better, that you can tell yourself, oh, I got better today, then you know that you're being rewarded greatly for this. You have to believe that. You have to have that in your heart. That's where this character comes from. It comes from what's in your heart. You know, your intention. Your intention outweighs everything. Allah's mercy will first look at your intention. You can earn Allah's mercy through your intention, through what's in your heart. Allah will give you the reward of praying Fajr if you have the intention to wake up for it, but you still fell asleep. You still get the reward for that.
You know, when you just open the door and you look outside, and based on the weather and how you're feeling, you kind of know what kind of day it's going to be like. It's going to be a rough day or it's going to be a good day. You either feel good or you feel bad. And there's so much just in that one moment. And the Prophet ﷺ gave us this beautiful remembrance to start off our day outside of the home, right? So you wake up with fajr, with remembrance and things of that sort. But as you're opening your door in those moments and you're about to step out into the world, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, those two angels that are protecting you, they come next to you. And at that moment, when you say, Bismillah, wa tawakkaltu ala Allah, wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Bismillah wa tawakkaltu ala Allah wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. It's not a complicated form of remembrance. Bismillah, in the name of Allah. Tawakkaltu ala Allah, I put my trust in Allah. Wa la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. And there is no power or might except that which belongs to Allah. Prophet ﷺ said, when you say that as you're entering into the world, exiting outside of your house, those angels respond to you. And as you say Bismillah, they say Hudita. In the name of Allah, you've been guided. And you say, Tawakkaltu ala Allah, I've put my full trust in Allah. They say, Kufita, you've been defended against anyone that's going to try to harm you today. And then they say, Wala hawla wala quwwata illa billah, and there's no power or might except that which belongs to Allah. They say, Wuqita, and you've been protected from all harm for the day. And as you say that, as you're entering into this world, the two shayateen that come to attack you, two devils that want to attack you for the day, one of them says to the other, what can we do with a person who's been guided, defended, and protected? And so they know they can't mess with you for the entire day, and they abandon you for the rest of the day. This is a powerful connection.
I'm telling you God's words, not no hustle. And I'm gonna tell you, God is black.
God is black. Everybody knows God is white.
Everything the white man taught you, you accepted. He taught you you were a black heathen and you believed him. He taught you to worship a blonde, blue-eyed Jesus with white skin and you believed him. He taught you that black was a curse and you believed that. Did you ever look up the word black in a dictionary?
For what?
Did you ever study anything that wasn't part of some con?
What the hell for, man?
Come with me.
black, destitute of light, devoid of color, enveloped in darkness, hence utterly dismal or gloomy, as the future looked black.
Pretty good with them words, ain't you?
Soiled with dirt, foul, sullen, hostile, forbidding, as a black day. Foully or outrageously wicked, as black cruelty, indicating disgrace, dishonor, or culpability. And there's others. Black male, black ball, black guard.
Yeah, well, that's something all right.
Let's look up white. Here. Read.
White. Of the color of pure snow. Reflecting all the rays of the spectrum. The opposite of black. Free from spot or blemish. Innocent. Pure. Huh. Ain't this something? Without evil intent, harmless, honest, square dealing, and honorable. Wait a minute, but this was written by white folks though, right? I mean, this white folks' book?
This sure ain't no black man's book.
So what we reading this one for?
Because the truth is lying there. If you read behind the words, you got to take everything the white man says and use it against him.
How the owner of the Cleveland Cavaliers talked about poor brother like he betrayed Cleveland by moving somewhere else. But guess what? We did the research. Let's look at who the commissioners of sports are. Yes, still on the plantation. Let me show you. David Stern, Jewish, National Basketball Association Commissioner. Maurice Podoloff, the first president of the NBA. Bud Selig, Major League Baseball Commissioner. Gary Bettman, National Hockey League Commissioner. Mark Cohan, Canada, Canadian Football League Commissioner. Don Garber, Major League Soccer Commissioner. Sidney Halter, the first commissioner of the Canadian football field. Now, Leslie Alexander, Jewish, owns the Houston Rockets. Mickey Arison is the owner of the Miami Heat. Our brother went from one plantation owner who is Jewish to another plantation owner who is Jewish. And the Jewish owner in Miami was jumping up and down because these Negroes sitting here like they are the top stars. But in the background is the dude that's saying, boy, we gonna get $750 million coming in because of these three Negroes. They're meat on a plantation. So Mr. Gilbert is hot with Mickey Arison. And guess what? They went for less money. Because see, black folk today can't be bought all the way out with money. They want a championship ring. A ring. Damn. Look at you. Boy, you're the craziest people. But God said he would choose a foolish people, and we certainly fit the bill, don't we? See, you strong, strapping Negroes. You Negroes that are good for sport. And every time you play, he gets rich. Every time you sport, he gets rich. You're on a plantation, brother. And when your days of playing are over, what's your condition? What's your condition? What's their condition? But Bob Arum, the Jewish guy, got the whole thing. Every black man today that's rich, he has friendship with a Jewish person. And it's that friendship that has made Jay-Z, P. Diddy, has made Russell Simmons, Beyonce. All our people got plenty of money. Oprah, plenty of money. But they have never learned how to network their money to produce real wealth for our people. So all the friendship that they have that makes them rich was never good enough to make us rich as a people. And so, beloved, in delivering this message, I know it may bring hurt to me and to us, but I also know that we will have the victory.
They try to suppress you, but that's how they try to categorize.
They can't control me. You get what I'm saying? They can control Shaq. They can control Charles Barkley. They can control LeBron James. They can control Jay-Z or Beyonce.
But not you, man.
But they can't control me. You
not
see,
you.
It ain't no name I won't name.
Exactly.
It's up.
Not you.
You know what I'm saying? And just for Minister Farrakhan, I love you, but the way you read that, I took that as a slight. You know what I'm saying? I'm taking no disrespect from nobody, so let's get on the phone and let's talk that out. I don't care who you are. I ain't taking no slights from nobody, right? I ain't taking no slights from nobody. It's God. That's the only person that I serve. My mom ain't here. My mama was sacrificed.
Me too.
You understand?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
Michael Jordan, what about him? His daddy, right? Bill Cosby, his son, right? Dr. Dre, his son. You know, out in Hollywood, a lot of people come up missing. Feels like it might be a lot of that in order to control, traumatize. They want to monetize and traumatize. And God loved me. You understand? They hit me. Gap, Adidas, all that away. Still, Forbes, who hate me, right, had to write net worth $400 million. God loved me.
That's more important than thinking about it.
That's the thing. You know what I'm saying? And this truth is going to be heard. I can't send none of y'all Meek Mills, y'all Puffies, y'all Lil Boozy, none of these names, none of these people that have to listen to y'all because they're dealing, they have legal. I never killed nobody, right? I'm the pussy that never killed nobody, right? But that means I can say whatever I want and not go to jail.